Hello, and welcome to Star Wars Obsessed. I'm Richard, and this is another episode of A Fan Reads the Star Wars Vault. Let's begin. When a deal is not quite a deal. While Lucasfilm had a deal memo with 20th Century Fox to make what was then called The Star Wars, that meant little without a firm commitment to actually pay for the movie. That depended on a final script, a reasonable budget, and a leap of faith on the part of the Fox board of directors. After all, everyone knew that sci-fi films, which were all the rage in the 1950s, didn't have an audience anymore. Even Stanley Kubrick's now critically acclaimed 2001 A Space Odyssey took 7 years to make back its $10.5 million budget. To help him, as well as his hoped-for backers, visualize his distant galaxy, George Lucas hired a former aerospace industry artist and free spirit named Ralph McQuarrie. George and Ralph had originally met in 1973 when some friends of Lucas hired Ralph to create concept paintings for a fantasy movie. In the fall of 1974, Lucas enlisted McQuarrie's help for a few weeks, a job that, off and on, stretched to nearly a decade. At their first working meeting at McQuarrie's Los Angeles apartment, Lucas brought the draft of the script and a bunch of clippings torn from comics and magazines to give the artist some idea of the movie playing in his mind. There was talk of Flash Gordon serials, but also of Errol Flynn pirate swashbucklers. This was no 2001, McQuarrie remembers Lucas saying, but a fantasy for kids who had few heroes. A clear story of good versus evil in which the good guys won, at least for now. McQuarrie had ideas and inspirations of his own. While he was then best known for his commercial art for Boeing and later for illustrations used during CBS News' live coverage of the Apollo program, he had the far-out imagination of an untamed hippie and the demeanor of a flower child of the peace and love generation. It was a combination that would serve Lucas well. Within a half hour of Lucas's departure, McQuarrie was at his drafting table churning out small, impressionistic pencil sketches to capture the essence of what the movie maker had talked about and shown him. In early 1975, after about 5 weeks and abundance of sketches, comments, and changes from Lucas, McQuarrie had come up with a set of 5 paintings that captured the look and feel the director hoped to put on the screen. Those paintings helped Fox's Alan Ladd Jr. finally convince his board of directors to go ahead and greenlight the movie, even though some still continue to insist, up to the opening, that the movie was sheer folly. Reinventing King Kong. The field of special effects cinematography was all but non-existent in Hollywood when Lucas was struggling with the pre-production of his film. That was a disheartening state of affairs, since Lucas's movie would surely require more special effects than had ever been attempted and of a style never before seen. Rather than try to cobble together the remnants of a moribund industry, Lucas decided to build his special effects house from the ground up, recruiting new talent from college campuses and through the recommendations of friends. He did enlist 2 veterans of recent effects films. Model maker Colin Cantwell had worked on 2001 A Space Odyssey. Effects supervisor John Dykstra came fresh out of 1972's Silent Running. The rest of the team, from concept designers to storyboard artists to explosions photographers, came largely untested. The crew, now christened Industrial Light and Magic, ILM, rented out a large warehouse in the middle of Los Angeles' San Fernando Valley and got to work designing models, effects shots, and equipment, the kind of technological innovation needed to pull off the effects shots Lucas had in mind. Dynamic, fluid shots filled with movement simply did not exist at the time and required a substantial amount of research and development before a single frame could be shot. This extended pre-production time became an item of contention in the months leading up to Star Wars' principal photography, when hundreds of shots were delayed in order to perfect the equipment needed to shoot them. Chief among this hardware was the Dykstraflex camera, named after its designer, which was the first completely computer-controlled camera system that allowed for 7 axes of motion and could duplicate the same moves in multiple takes. This was a crucial innovation to get the shots of X-Wings and TIE Fighters in battle, the Millennium Falcon escaping the Death Star, or the jaw-dropping Star Destroyer flyover that opens the movie. Also key was the battered, lived-in look of the galaxy far, far away. While the used future look is taken for granted by today's moviegoers, it was one of the standout features that early Star Wars audiences talked about. People just hadn't considered the fact that equipment, no matter how advanced or futuristic, is prone to the forces of entropy and decay. ILM model makers and the art department in the UK, led by production designer John Barry, designed the models, actual sets, and full-size vehicles with burns, scorches, exhaust marks, and exposed panels, lending them a dimension of credibility against an unreal backdrop of stars, planets, and a moon-sized space station. By early 1977, the special effects shots were still behind schedule, with just months to go before Star Wars was to open. But like the rogue who arrives in the nick of time to save the day, ILM delivered the goods. And what dazzling goods they were. The groundbreaking effects seen in Star Wars were hailed by audiences and critics alike and raised the bar for visual effects in movies forever. All right, that was really cool. Thank you for watching. Check out other Star Wars Obsessed videos here. Don't forget to click like and subscribe. See you on the next episode of A Fan Reads The Star Wars Vault.